Hello. Hi, friends. Coming across your Friday Facebook news feed, popping up with a notification that I'm sure you could care less about. I am working on this tripod right now. You guys should see my setup sometimes. I'm very unprofessional. That should make you feel really good. Oh, anyway, so we're going to drum up an audience here and get going on a topic to make us nice and toasty for me on a chilly day in Ohio. We are like in the 10 degrees or something like that. So I'm Claire Smith and I am happy to be with you this afternoon. If you are here, why don't you tell me who you are and from where you are watching. And I have a number of things that we kind of need to go over, but today I'm actually gonna get into our teaching right away. We're going to get into the heart of the matter right away, and then I'm going to actually speak to some of the specific things with the Living and Active Challenge, because I know that there are some of you joining me that are not a part of the Living Active Challenge, and there are some of you who want to hear from me on that. So what I'm going to do first is we're going to discuss the heart of the matter, and that is the name of this video, which I'm sure you loved that, seeing that come across your feed. If you follow me on Instagram, you got a little bit of a preview of what we're talking about today. So, hey Esther, hey Liz, hey Whitney, Painesville, hey, that's right, you live up there near Holly. My in-laws are from there, my husband's from that area, so it is cold. It's sunny though, which is awesome, and I'm right by a window, so it's giving me some good lighting. So anyways, we'll just wait a little bit here and get this drummed up. I don't know if you guys came over from Instagram. If you're an Instagram person, make sure you follow me there. I do a lot of my updates. I think the updates are translating now over to my Facebook stories, but you can follow me there at Claire Smith Official. So, all right, guys, I've prayed a lot over this specific video. Just because some of the things we're going to talk about right now may be hard. It might be difficult to land on your heart and on your mind. So I want you first to know, and you should know this always, but I'm going to go ahead and remind you and put this out here, that number one, every time I come across to you and speak to you, it is not coming out of just like an angry spot or a place of flesh. It has come from a lot of prayer, and it has come from me really seeking God about what I'm speaking to you about. Secondly, I'm never asking you to do something that I am currently not doing or haven't worked through or trying to do myself, okay? I'm not gonna be one of those people that sits here and acts like I got it all together, but I have learned some things along the way. I listen to lots and lots of people. I have wise women in my life, and so I feel like part of what God has asked me to do is to use all those resources and combine it with my thoughts and share it with you to encourage you and to equip you and to give you some tools in this really difficult journey called life. Let's be honest, guys, it is not always the easiest thing. And I know that some of you watching me right now are in a great season of your life, while others of you are in a very frustrating season in your life. And I understand that. And so this message is gonna fall on each of you a little differently, but I trust that the Holy Spirit will take this message and it will hit you where you need to be hit and where it will go right to the heart, to the center, and we'll kind of go from there. So, hey Ingrid, it's good to see you on here. So, okay, well guys, I entitled this video, How a Modern Woman Tears Her House Down, and I hashtagged it Homewrecker. Homewrecker of a different kind. Now, I know the initial thought on what a homewrecker is clearly terrible. and I'm not using it in that context, as in we are women out there going and wrecking other people's homes with other marriages or something like that. But the basic idea of us kind of tearing our house down, and I'll tell you why we are talking about this today. In the Living and Active Challenge, which again, I will speak about more specifically in the end, we are in the second week of that. And this week's daily Bible reading is in Proverbs. We added that to the challenge this year. As I was going through Proverbs and choosing the passages, Proverbs 14, and especially verse 1, was one that I added to our reading. And I did that on purpose. I've wanted to talk to this issue for a little while. It's when I speak to women's events and all that good stuff. This is definitely something I talk to. If you're not familiar with what I'm talking about, the daily reading plan, this is free. This is on my blog, and I can link all that stuff later. But we're in the middle of a challenge, a five-week faith and fitness challenge. And, well, we're kind of at the beginning, sort of it. So that is where we're at. So we went through Proverbs 14 and then Proverbs 31 this week in our reading. So let me read the verse to you. There goes my notes. I'm going to read it in the NIV. I've probably quoted it 1,000 times in other versions as well. So it's up to you what version you like, but here's what it says. The wise woman builds her house, but with her own hands, the foolish one tears hers down. I don't know if you've ever heard that verse before. I was actually a young mom for the first time when I heard that verse. I don't think it ever probably stuck out to me as a teenager. Probably not while I was necessarily in college. It was when I hit the mom world that verse came out and was like, whoa, really pivotal in my life. And it's a very, very simple verse, but it is one that is packed with a lot. And that one verse is what we're going to go off of today. I'll also be referencing Proverbs 31. Now, many of you have probably heard about Proverbs 31. There's the Proverbs 31 Ministries even. And there is quite a bit to be said for what is in that passage as well. So what I want to kind of first start off with is what really I looked up. I like to look up words and meanings, and I also like to look like the Greek or the Hebrew up in the Bible. So when I study, that I go to town with all that stuff. I love to understand what the original meaning of something was, because we take it and we twist it into what we think it is. And simply when it talks about tearing down, it just says that it's throwing down and it's breaking. And again, it's this idea of just tearing down things with her own hands. And it is also just means that your own hands. It is the woman's own hands. And that's when it immediately came to me yesterday that it was essentially like we're homewreckers with our hands that we have going on. Now, here are a few things I want us to talk about. Number one, this message applies to all women. So I told you it didn't really pique my interest until I had children and I really had the idea of what a home context was, because I was building a home with my, you know, husband. When I say build inside, I was building. And not that this, you know, I don't know why, but it just pricked my heart then. But I want you to know that if you're watching this and you are a single woman that lives in a home, this applies. This does not say this is a married woman in this context or anything. It's just talking about a woman in her home context, okay? So this can apply to a single woman. This can apply to a divorced woman. This can apply to a married woman with zero children. This can apply to obviously married women with children, which is my case. But I understand in women's ministry, we're all at different places here. So what it is it's just saying it is a woman that lives in a home. So I want you first to apply and think to yourself, okay, what is my home context? Do I have a roommate? Do I have another girl that I live with? Or is it just my husband and I? Is it, you know, what does that look like for me? God's word applies to every single season of our life. It will be different every single season of our life, how he applies that. So that's number one. Number two, we all have different rooms in our house. I want you to think about when we think about our house. We have a living room. We have a kitchen. We have a bedroom. We have a bathroom. We have a basement. We have closets. There's a lot in the home that when we think about building it up or tearing it down, that we can be impacting. Okay, so when we do this, and I got this, I got a message from somebody after I posted this up yesterday. I was giving some preview hints about doing this video. Somebody wrote back and said for a women's event their church had, they actually, I don't know if they set up the church and then made specific rooms, like rooms, like they, women would go to a living room in one of the rooms. And they talked through, they had someone speaking through Proverbs 14:1 for the living room. And then they took them out and went into the kitchen. And they went and talked through Proverbs 14:1 in the kitchen. And they actually made it like an actual thing, like a practice. I thought that was so smart, like a great application of the word that I think we could all sit and really ponder. So if you're doing women's ministry, I say do that. That's like total two thumbs up on that one. So, but I want you to think about that here. So as we're talking about these things, we all have different rooms in our house. And so it's going to apply a little differently. Now, granted, I mean, the whole house as a, you know, a whole is what we're thinking, but we know that individually these things matter. The third thing I want to say is this. What is the common denominator in the house? What is the common denominator in the kitchen? What's the common denominator in the bedroom? What is the common denominator? Us, women, ourselves, okay? That is going to be the empowering piece to this whole message. I actually want you to know that this message is not something to be like, oh, I am not like living up to this type of a woman or whatever. This actually, after hearing this and understanding this, this should give you a little bit more like, oh, I have a lot of influence over my home. And we're not taking this and waving it in a heavy-handed way to be like some feminist person that's like, go women, go, I'm gonna smash down everybody in my house or something. That maybe was a bad generalization, but I think you know what I mean. We are sitting here doing this to say we are empowered to make a difference and an impact in our homes. And we do indeed make a huge difference in our homes. If you think you don't, that's incorrect. The Bible is very clear. If you can destroy your house, that's pretty impactful. And if you can also build it up, that's pretty impactful. So I want you to know that us as women have such amazing influence and power in a general sense over what we do in our houses, okay? That should change everything. And now we're gonna get into that. All right, so I was starting to write out, like, what does this actually look like? What does this specifically look like to tear down your house? And I started to go through point one, point two, and I was just like brainstorming some things that I see in my own life that I've done, or other people, or anything like that. But really, there's one really simple thing that we have to always remember. And if I think we keep this and we remind ourselves of this, and we pray about this, God will show us. And the key is that you are a wise woman. That's the key. It is the wise woman who builds her house, and it's the foolish one who tears it down. I know it sounds really simplistic, but that's going to be the differentiator. And what wisdom is in your house is different than how it applies in my house. What wisdom looks like in one season of your life, in one season of your marriage, and one season of raising the specific child that you've got or kids, that looks different than other seasons, okay? Wisdom is the key. That is the root cause or the root foundation. Now, how do we get wisdom, guys? The Bible tells us the wisdom comes from God. Proverbs tells us that time and time again. We seek God for every single thing we do. Does he give us practical people and advice and people who've paved the way to help us have knowledge? Yeah, absolutely. But at the end of the day, what you really need to be is a wise woman in your house. Now, that should also free you up. That should make you kind of be like, okay, you mean I don't have to do it like her? And the answer is correct. Exactly. As a matter of fact, I sure hope you're not. If God is saying, I want you to do it like this, and you're trying to do it like her, that's probably one way that you're tearing your house down, is you're trying to make it like someone else. And if I know one thing about women, it's that we like to compare and one up on someone and try to do it like someone else. Okay. And, that doesn't work. That's why there's freedom in the Bible. That's why there's freedom in living and loving Jesus. I know it looks from an outsider's point of view that it's just so constrictive. It's not. It's the best freedom in the world because you actually fall into the sink of God's best for you and your life and your family. And there's so much peace that kind of that comes from that. So with that being said, what's that look like? And I also wanted to reference, Proverbs 31, one of the verses in there, Proverbs 31:26. which again, you can kind of go through Proverbs 31 if you'd like to. Now that talks about the wife of noble character. But it says this, she speaks with wisdom and faithful instruction is on her tongue. I could have pulled a number of verses that talked about wisdom just to support that fact, but just know that that is a big thing that you're going to be speaking with wisdom when we're in our homes. Okay, so let's get to the nitty gritty. Let's get to some of the things that I did a quick short list. This is not comprehensive. This is not in any specific order. These are just some things that I see women who I believe are able to impact their homes in a godly manner kind of do. Okay, number one is they seek others first. So if you want to tear your house down, then if you're not wise, you would seek others' opinions first. That's what I mean by that. So if you want to live foolishly, don't ask God first, okay? If you want to live foolishly, talk to everybody else on the block, all of your girlfriends, look at all the blog posts, and never ask God what you should be doing in your family and how that looks. Should you go paleo? Should you spend this type of money on this type of exercise program? Do you let your kids do Fortnite or not? I don't know. I'm just going to throw some things out there. What do all these things? Go ahead. If you want to tear your house down, then start asking everybody else and don't seek God. Okay, we know that a wise woman seeks God first, and that's a wise man as well, okay? So we want to make sure that we're always seeking God first. Okay, if you want to tear your house down, look at worldly wisdom. Okay, look at the things that the world would say, chase this, store up treasures here in your house. Don't store up treasures in heaven. Look at what the world would say, which would be in contrast to what the Bible would say. That's going to tear your house down because that doesn't carry any wisdom. If you want to tear your house down, think short term. Always think short term. Never think that there's a bigger picture going on. Never think that there is something long term that you're chasing and that you're building up in your child. There are things with our kids that we're working on that we could easily give them a short answer and a fix with. That is not going to teach our kids to endure. It's not going to teach them the character to stand on when they're out on their own. And so if I want to tear my house down, I'm going to think short term. But if I'm a woman that wants to build this house up, then I'm going to constantly be thinking, what is the long term? How am I storing up treasures in heaven in the things of our house? Okay, so there's that. Another thing to tear down your house, and this is where it gets a little tricky, is she doesn't protect her energy. And this is obviously going to be something I speak to a lot because of self-care and the different things that we have here, but a wise woman knows how to protect her energy. Now, if you're not sure, like, what does that mean? It sounds like a little creepy, you know, woo-ah, what are you talking about? It simply means to know that you have a limit. You have a capacity that you hit, okay? Everybody's is different. Every season is different. Every personality is different as well. You need to know when that capacity is at the limit or when it's down or where you hit it. A wise woman knows how to steward her energy. And she does that in a number of ways. She says no to other commitments. She fills herself up with the right things. She gets enough sleep. She's eating healthy, nutritious foods. When she notices something's off in her hormones or perhaps her emotions, she's willing to go down the route and ask, you know, doctors or natural doctors or anybody, a therapist, go see that. She knows that her energy impacts the space that she walks in. You guys know this to be true, and if you don't know it to be true, ask your husband, ask your friends, ask your kids. When mama ain't happy, finish the phrase. No one's happy. Okay, my husband is that for sure. I've gotten, accused of that a ton, okay? So I'm sitting here saying, like, I'm not perfect in this area too. I have to watch this. My energy, my attitude impacts the space of my house more than you would think. So am I building up by that, or am I tearing down my house by the, just again, what I'm bringing, the attitude that I have, you know, to this? And so I think it's really important. If you want to tear your house down, don't steward the time well. Spend your time either way too much obsessing over your house or way too much outside of your house. Spend your time running your kids all over God's creation. And that is a way that you are going to tear that house down instead of building it up. Because again, let's go back to the wisdom principle. The wisdom principle is that we have a specific allotted amount of time and grace and energy that we are given to do what God has asked us to do every single day. If we are living outside of that in any capacity, okay, if we're living outside of that, then that is not where God has his protection and his best for us. It's not the best for us as wise women to be living a life that's overextended, if you will. Okay, so we're really smart about our time. We're thinking about, how does that impact our time? Have we had enough family time? Have we had enough time to have friends in our house to connect in some way? What does that look like with, again, the commitments that you have? Okay, so I think a wise woman will build her house up in knowing that. Another way that a woman would tear her house down is she fights in the flesh. I probably should have started out with this one. Is that everything is a fleshly battle. Now, if you're kind of like, what does that mean? I don't get that. Okay, so the Bible talks about we have the flesh and the spirit. Romans 8 talks about it, and we have a number of verses. Ephesians 6 says that our fights, our struggles are in the spiritual realm, not in the flesh and blood. A wise woman knows that when there is tension in the house, when there's tension with your children, when there's tension with your spouse, yourself personally, when there are things going crazy all over the place, she knows that she has to first fight that battle in the spiritual realms, which means she hits her knees, which means she's constantly on her knees. She's not fighting the flesh first. Now, that doesn't mean you just turn an eye and you don't actually address issues. I mean, gosh, that's a whole nother discussion about women just allowing things to happen in their lives and it's not conducive. It actually, yeah, turns into bad things. It does mean that we're going to be addressing issues in that. But number one, a wise woman knows that the battle is in the spirit realm. If you are a Christian woman and have the Holy Spirit in you, and your husband, luckily, hopefully he does too, if you have a husband, or your children, okay, you are in a battlefield in your home, all right? It's not going to come easily. Yet we, and this is nature, this is what happens. We look at the other person or the friends or whoever we're living with, and it ends up being this little fleshly battle. And so a wise woman is gonna not fight first in the flesh, or actually really never, we always fight in the spirit. We address, of course, the rooted issues as needed, but we first see God. We ask him first. That's a powerful woman. You are building your house up so much by inviting the Holy Spirit into your home, whatever that looks like, okay? So that's how we build a house up. Another thing is this, her confidence is in Christ. Her confidence is not in the house or the people or the things in the house. The confidence of a wise woman, that's exactly what it looks like. It's in Christ. And it's not in anything that can be taken from her. While that stuff can be managed, but if you want to tear your house down, put your confidence in your husband. Ask him to be your God. Now, I know that sounds extreme, but that's what we call having an idol in our life. The Bible talks about having idols of the heart, okay? So one of the things that we do is we ask our husband or our kids good things, amazing things, to be our everything. We put everything, our confidence, our hope. They define us. They tell us what love is. They give us our worth. They give us our purpose. All right, you want to tear your house down? Go ahead and let them be your gods. If you want to build your house up, you say, God, you and you alone. Everyone else will come down in their correct order. And God, in his protection and provision, he knows this. This is how he set it up. That then is where your house flourishes. Okay, so we sometimes have to check ourselves to see, has something kind of come up in our heart in regards to having an idol and our confidence in them. So those are just some of my quick, ideas of how we can tear the house down and how we can build it up. I want to leave you with a couple thoughts. The cool thing is this, is a woman has a choice. We can either build or we can tear. That's what I love about it. It's not like you're just like, well, this is it, Claire, your hands are tied. You are, that's all. I have a choice every day. The choice is before me when I wake up and I walk downstairs. So whether your house is filled with tons of people or no people, you have a choice with how you are going to build your house up. Are you going to or are you not? Are you going to live in wisdom or are you going to be foolish, like the Bible says? So we have a choice. Now with building, think about what that looks like. It's an action word. Build requires some intentionality. If we think about building a house, for example, somewhere else, or hey, let's just say building our body. If you're trying to put on some more muscle or get a little stronger in certain ways, do you just haphazardly throw it together? No, there's a plan. And that again is where wisdom comes in. There is intention. You are looking at your house and God is like, hey, Claire, I've given you some influence in this family. Actually, a lot. How are you building this house up? How are you building it up in love? Where are the holes that you see in this house? Is it a house of love? Is it a house of grace? Is it a house of service? How are you teaching? How are you inviting people in here? Now let's get a plan around that and let's build that up. That's awesome, guys. I know you've got a lot of energy and I know that a lot of you are scrolling, yet you want to not just be scrolling all day long on your social media. You want to do something that matters. I know you do. I know you feel that tension. I've been there. Okay, so let's get a plan and build your house. Again, it requires that action. It requires you to get up and do it. And then, of course, we have to remember prayer. We have to bathe all of this in prayer, which is kind of what I was saying earlier, that is exactly what a wise woman is going to always be doing, is thinking about all of this. Psalm 127:1 says this, "Unless the Lord builds the house, its builders labor in vain." Unless the Lord builds the house, its builders labor in vain. In vain just means it's all for show. It's shallow. It's nothing deep and foundational. Okay, we want to build our house, women. Yes, we do. But we have to have the Lord in it as we build our house. So that means since we are the common denominator, as we walk through this house and as we work through different phases, I know I'm talking to some of you right now. Your house looks different, and when I say your house, I mean who's in it, than what it was a year ago at this time. Something has happened in your family and in your relationship, good or bad. And you're the common denominator, though. You are the woman that God is speaking to here. And he said, have you forgotten? Have you forgotten what I have said? Have you forgotten how I've empowered you? Women are amazing. And I'm not saying that just because I am one, but I think we're pretty awesome. I think the way we can think and love and multitask and get things done, we do things with passion. We have big hearts. We see things in such an amazing way. God has made us uniquely. I'm glad I'm not a man. I'm not trying to be a man. I'm trying to be the woman God has created me to be. And he is sitting here breathing life into us in this verse and saying, you have that type of influence. Now, steward it well. So that's so crucial, so huge in everything that we do. So that is kind of in essence what I had for you on how we tear up and build, tear down and build up. I'm sure I could talk about it a little bit more. And let's look at some of the comments here. Ingrid said, happy wife, happy life. Yes, Ingrid. Amen. Let's see. Oh, you guys are welcome. Liz said, don't forget, God is not surprised at your current situation. So perfect. so perfect. Yes, if you are in a situation where it looks different this year right now than where you were a year ago, you might be surprised, but God is not. God is not surprised. But again, he has the Holy Spirit living in you, and he wants you to follow that leading. And again, I want to just encourage you, this looks different house to house, woman to woman, and even in your own life. I look at how my role in this house has changed a little bit, and different things I have to shift and focus on from, I don't know, 10 years ago, or when it was just my husband and I at the house, versus right now with a 12-year-old and a 9-year-old. How you can't just say, well, that's how it's always been and it's going to stay that way. That's one of the worst things that we can do. Okay. So again, we want to manage our, our bodies. You guys, this is why my heart for taking care of yourself. This is kind of, in essence, one of the big reasons I want you to. I want you to have a clear mind. And we know that minds are affected by lack of sleep, stress, food, chemicals. There are chemical imbalances, absolutely, depression, anxiety, a clear mind. I want your body to feel, all right, I can take this on. Like this kind of external, there's no doubt it's all connected. I want you to be able to sleep well. I want you to be able to manage your schedule. I want you to be able to, you know, take care of the foods that you have in your house, however that looks, however you get healthy food in your house and try to eat that, drink water. Those are so important, but most importantly, guys, don't miss it. It is wisdom. It is a wise woman who does this, and wisdom comes from God and God alone. That is the number one key. That's what I want to help you guys do. That's why we have the Living and Active Challenge, is I'm hoping you guys build up these disciplines, okay? The ability to say, I'm going to train my mind and my body and my soul, and I'm going to get up and I'm going to train my mind and my body and my soul, and I'm going to get up and I'm going to keep doing it when it's not flashy, when it's not sexy, okay? I'm going to keep doing it because God is working there, okay? So if you have any other questions, let me know. You can put them down below there. I'm going to just real quick run in over to some stuff for the Living and Active Challenge. So if you're a part of that, and there's going to be actually, I'm going to be talking to two specific issues here that some of you have asked me about in regards to your health. Number one, if you're on the Living and Active Challenge, don't forget to check in. You guys have until Sunday to check in from last week. It's all up on the blog. If you have a question, let me know about that. And then I will be giving you your new information on Sunday night. I hope you guys are enjoying the Bible reading if you're doing it, and the various verses. And also, we have a Facebook group, which has been great. I try to pop in there as best as I can. It's been a really crazy couple weeks for me. One of the things I keep finding that's a difficult thing for people during the challenge, and this is very understandable, is something called real life. Something called when your kids get sick. Something called when your husband has to all of a sudden leave town and travel. When you're just like, I'm tired, work's crazy and stressful. I'm not able to keep this up. I cannot keep up the discipline. This is a big part of my message. This is something that I talk to quite a bit. I want you to embrace your real life. I don't want you to get resentful at it. Your life has been given to you on purpose and for a reason. And there are a number of things we cannot control. And I am the first to tell you that. This challenge is simply a challenge. It's simply here for you if it works for your phase of life. You may get 1, 2, 3 weeks into it and realize like, whoa, I'm on the crazy train right now. I didn't see this all coming. And I can't finish the challenge as it is defined. And I want you to know that's fine. I understand that 110%, okay? Now, what this doesn't mean though is that you have to throw everything out the window, that you kind of have to be like, well, I'm just not going to work out at all. Since I can't do 5 weeks and I can't do 4 days a week at 25 minutes, I can't memorize this verse, forget it. I'm throwing it all out the window. Where's the Oreos? That happens a lot. I don't want you to do that. I want you to think about how now can I live out of my reality? How can I adjust a little bit? Where can I tweak it to make this work for me and my season? And that is really, truly how you make it a lifestyle. Everyone talks about like a lifestyle, like changing everything. I want to make my health a lifestyle. But on the other hand, like it doesn't always, people don't always do like do it. Like they don't want to actually make it a lifestyle. So making it a lifestyle means it fits in your life. Okay. So if you're there, it's okay. I want you just to make some little adjustments. The other thing someone had mentioned was in the evening, she falls apart and eats everything, like stays really good on track with what the eating is for the day. But by the time the evening comes, it's kind of either this like, I deserve this. It's an entitlement. I've written about this before. Like you're entitled to eat the food that you have, or like the ice cream, or the kids are gone. They're asleep. So I'm going to sit here and enjoy this, you know, food with my family. And then everything falls apart. So there's a number of things to this. Number one, I would just make sure you're getting enough calories during the day. I know that there's a lot of women who actually do not get enough calories in the day because they're just running around. Now, they may not be eating great calories. They may be eating like half peanut butter sandwiches, little bits of goldfish here, leftover yogurt. I got two kids. I know what it's like, okay? So sometimes you're not eating enough calories. So when you actually stop for a second, sit down with your husband, make sense why you all of a sudden your body's like hungry. And so you kind of go from there. So I think you want to make sure you have enough calories. The second thing is that I'm not against people eating at night. I know there are some people who are like, it's the worst thing in the world. Don't eat at night. I'm okay with you eating at night as long as what you're eating, isn't going to trigger you into eating a whole bunch more junk. For the most part, most people aren't eating chicken, rice, broccoli, or a healthy scoop of peanut, or you know, peanut butter and celery or something like that. Typically people go nuts at night. And that's why I close the kitchen up at night for me, and I stop eating at about 7 o'clock and I don't touch any other food. Now, weekends and we have friends over and stuff like that, I do. But for the most part, I don't even let myself go back in there, because if I go back in there, do you know how many calories I can consume quickly? A lot. Let's just say you consume an extra 200 calories, which is not hard to do. That adds up quick every night. So I personally, for me, unless you have it planned, you know, unless you're like, no, I know what I'm going to eat and I've got it in control, then that's great. Go ahead and eat that. I don't have an issue with you eating at 8 or 9 or 10 p.m. It's very individual. You just need to be honest with yourself. You just need to just kind of know. The other thing is this, I will say, there have been studies that attach the more decisions you make in a day, you have something called decision fatigue. And decision fatigue has been attached to low willpower. So as you can imagine, by the end of the day, you've made lots of decisions, from what outfit am I going to wear? Am I going to eat this food or that food? Do I turn right at the stoplight or do I turn left at the stoplight? Is my kid going to be in part of that baseball team or is my kid not going to be part? Imagine, you guys know what it's like. Our brains, that's why we like crash at night. The more decisions you make in a day, there have been studies that say that your willpower goes, so you just need to know that your willpower is less at night. So do with that what you want. I think science is powerful. I doubt you can decrease the amount of decisions you have in a day. You might be able to by like planning ahead, like what food you're going to eat and what outfit you're going to wear or something like that. But other than that, if you live in the real world, it's not that easy to plan decisions like that last minute or ahead of time. So those are my thoughts there. And then it doesn't, you know, sit down and have a cup of tea. I wrote about this on my Instagram stories last week about removing something and then replacing it with something else. So when I remove, if you're trying to adjust out of eating at night, I don't like to just be like, well, okay, now what do I do? You can replace it. Now you can replace it with a cup of tea or something like that. I wouldn't say a cup of coffee. Or some sparkling water. That doesn't sound exciting, does it, guys? Or an activity. You know, you could replace it with reading a devotional at night. You could replace it with some journaling or a write an encouragement card or spend some time with your husband or whatever. So, you know, there's different ways that you can attach that. So it's just, you got to know yourself and you got to play around with some different options. But the evening, it can be a hard time for a lot of people. So anyways, okay, do you guys have any questions? I was all over the place today. So yes, hey Sheridan, wisdom, knowledge, and you got that right. Okay, so All right. Well, if you guys have any questions, leave them below. Feel free to share this with a friend. Thanks for listening and hanging in there on this difficult topic. I hope it encouraged you. If there's anything else you want me to talk about, let me know. I may swing back around on this topic again in some different format. So anyways, all right, guys, thank you so much. Have a fantastic weekend and we'll talk later.